to which I invite you to come. I'd like to dedicate this talk to late Konstantin Yefetov, with whom I've been collaborating on part of the ideas that I will present in this talk. And so he passed away on August 11th, and I think it's a great loss for the community at large. So here are the little team with whom some of the results have been derived. I will not really present the results of this talk, more like a general overview, personal, on cuprate fields. So Maxence Grandadam is finishing PhD, and Anorak is now postdoc in Israel, and Saïli is postdoc at the KIT in Karlsruhe. Oops. So that's the mystery that everyone knows in this room. So I remind that it was pointed out experimentally very soon after the discovery of those compounds. I cite NMR, and this is the result by the group of Henri Alloul. And this is a pseudo gap over there. So at the temperature over there, there is a big mystery that there is a loss of density of states for electronic density of states. So at the time, they were able to distinguish between the signal which would be magnetic and electronic in nature. That's how they could dump it, that it's a pseudo gap, so it's not really a gap, but you could see already in a night shift the loss of density of states. So there were further, now we know experimentally a bit better what's going on. And especially if you look at the Fermi surface of those compounds, and this is not observed experimentally, but it's what theories predict of doping emote insulator. And what's been observed experimentally is this. It's not the most recent by Arpes, and this one. So we know two things. We know that high doping, and this looks like the normal Fermi liquid surface. And at low doping, it's as if you had a hole pocket, so you dope, but you cannot observe that, so we don't know if it's really what is seen. And in between, we see this, which maybe are closing on the backside, maybe not, so it's called Fermi arcs. And those Fermi arcs are still a mystery, and they are the key to understand the various theoretical approaches to this field. So cuprates, it's led by experiments. That's why I start with two experiments. But the complexity is so high that a lot of very new and intriguing ideas have emerged on that, compounds. And that's why it's so interesting. Maybe most of the ideas, and actually maybe we are lucky if one of them explains everything. But at least they are original, and they make progress in the theory and also in experiments. Okay, so that's what I want to do. I want to classify all theoretical approaches in three packages. Some which consider that the main thing that you see when you see this type of phase diagram, which is from Brad Ramshaw, you see that you have a Mott insulator, namely you have a very strong Coulomb repulsion on site where the electron live their life. And this is a key somehow to the pseudo-gap state. So you have other approaches. Sorry, I'm not going the right direction. Which go the opposite way and say, okay, but here we have a Fermi liquid that we saw the Fermi surface is well defined, at least we don't have Fermi arcs or whatever, and it's big, it's normal, it's basically what you obtain when you do tight binding without interactions from a Fermi surface. So what we know and what it seems to indicate, actually this data is a specific heat as function of doping, that you seem to have some kind of quantum critical point under the dome. So this type of approaches say, but look, the pseudo gap is just a hidden phase transition. We just don't know the order parameter. Maybe it's a bit broadened by some disorder, but somehow it's kind of a hidden order with a QCP over there. And last but not least, you have fluctuations in the system for many reasons. And one of the reasons is when you approach a mode transition, your particles, say, localize. when they localize, the phase fluctuate. So basically, all the fields in the system will have some phase fluctuations over there, which we will see are quite important. Sorry. Okay, I will go a bit in details for the tree approach. The first one is maybe the most popular for many years. It is the one that was led by Phil Anderson and many, many big thinkers in the field. Here is a paper I take from a review by Patrick Lee. So this ring is a zonetic Vader's bond. So due to this presence of the strong coupling and MOT insulators, what the electrons do is they put 2 by 2 as pairs over there, and they form singlets. So they form a superposition of singlet, a coherent one, of all size. And that's the ansatz for the pseudo gap. So there was a theory to describe that, which was a theory which cuts the electron, is fractionalized the electron. So you can fractionalize the electron, you have emerging gauge fields. Here, it is a U1 that I took. So the electron here lose under strong Coulomb interaction, it loses its integrity, and it splits into spin and charge, spin on and hold on. And in order to preserve the phase space, you need to impose a constraint, which is also something going on with emerging gauge fields. And the constraint is telling you that the whole charge and spins are conserved, so it's either a spin on or a roll on per side. So if you do that, you can do a simple mean field for the phase diagram and say, oh, but okay, these roll ons, they will condense under this line as function of a doping. And the spin ons, what they do, they will pair 2 by 2, and the pairing will go over this line. So in here, number 2 is a pseudo gap. So you see the electron is what we call, the field theory is deconfined, and the electron is split into spin on and hold on. And when the boson condenses here, so whole condensation, the electron reconfines and recovers its integrity. So it's a fractionalization theory. It's kind of very demanding idea, almost as crazy. I would say, no, not crazy, it's not a good word, but as original as the one presented by Valérie Vinocourt with the Dyons this morning. Here you have this transmetal and here this below the blue line, so electron has reconfined and you get a fermi liquid back. So this is the first approach, and it requires something very, very, it says like the pseudo gap, something very unusual when we observe deconfined gauge theories and can be described by emergent gauge field and deconfined gauge theories. Sorry, again, I'm going always in line. Personally, don't believe in it. I mean, still in terms of belief. So then I will tell you what is my favorite of all, but I want to make a panorama first. The reason I don't believe in it anymore is like here we are in superconducting phase and look at ARPA studies, and they look at this region in superconducting phase. And what we see is Bogolyubov quasi-particles. These are this type of excitation inside the pseudo gap in the antinodal region. If I really had a pseudo gap which was made of deconfined electrons, fractionalized electrons, I probably could not observe Bogolyubovs, which are extremely coherent excitation of the superconductors. So I suppose if I observe Bogolyubov quasi-particles, my electron must be one, so not spin on hold on. That's what I'm saying. That's personally why I don't believe in it anymore. Sorry, I'm really bad. So the second one is the fluctuations, if you remember. So they are not completely opposite to one another. Of course, when you reach the mode transition, you will have more fluctuations. You have another source of fluctuations because you are in two dimensions. So they could very well be a patchwork of the tree, which could, at the end of the day, the dust will settle and we will know what is this pseudo gap. I mean, it's a very mysterious state of matter. There will be one solution, not two. So maybe the solution will be a patchwork of the tree. The system is kind of complex. If not, we would already know what it is by now. So fluctuations. Oh, what is this? Oh no. So I completely lost. Not even know if I go in the right direction here. bad. Oh. Sorry, I'm really sorry. I did something with a command that I didn't know. So you see the... Ah, this is close. Sorry. Go, 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 down, 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 down. No, no, up, I mean, up, 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 up. Sorry. We will not go through all that. I'm so, very sorry about that. I just don't... No, 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 stop, 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 stop. Yeah. I try not to make a mistake. I think I... Sorry. Ah, no, it was not sufficient. So QCP under the dome, the third one. Yeah, now the mic. Sorry, I was a bit disturbed. So QCP under the dome is something which is ubiquitous in quantum materials. And that's quite interesting because you have a lot of examples where you have a superconducting phase and some magnetism. Here is antiformagnetism with heavy fermions. Here you have two superconducting domes, but you might have a valence transition for this one. And not least, in a unique diet, you have also antiformagnetism, superconductivity. So something which is extremely, almost everywhere, and you have these QCPs which are sitting under the dome and could lead to fluctuations. Here is a kind of very fashionable compound which is very much studied right now, but it's with ferromagnetism. So when we know now that superconductivity and magnetism are not really foos, and somehow this, you could have a lot of fluctuations behind the dome. Try to do the right way. Yeah, okay. So now the QC fluctuations. So this is an old idea again. This is another school of thought to approach this system. And you look at, you calculate, I mean, the you evaluate from the compound the rigidity of the phase fluctuations of superconducting pairs. And you are able to say in this paper by Emery and Kivelson from 95, that compared to usual superconductor, the cup rates are 10 to the power of 5, I don't know if you see, there's a 5 here, less rigid than a usual cup rate superconductor. So phase fluctuation, we know they fluctuate a lot. Now, is it enough to create a pseudo gap or not? Just sorry, I'm really bad with it. And again, that was something that I take that was very much highlighted by Ivan Bozovic yesterday. There is also this very intriguing plot of the superfluid density as function of TC, where this is linear in temperature, which is typical of BKT transition in 2D. Namely, the transition would be accompanied by the creation of vortices that would lead the phase transition at TC. So this is a fact. I mean, this is very striking. So again, these phase fluctuations, vortices are present. How far are they going to be? So here, sorry, it's missing a transparency, but there was a study in roughly 10 years ago of the Nernst effect, which was that pure phase fluctuations, they are very strong, but they don't seem to go up to T star. They seem to stop from the Nernst effect story a few degrees above TC, I mean, right inside the pseudo gap. On the other hand, you have the beautiful noise experiment that Ivan Bozovic mentioned yesterday, which is that you have some kind of incoherent pairs in the pseudo gap phase and even beyond. So the idea here that I would like to advocate, and it's a work we developed with Constantin over the last years before his passing, is that when you talk about fluctuations, let's say we have a boson, you have a condensate here, you have, of course, phase fluctuations, which have been studied thoroughly by theoreticians, especially for cuprates, but not only. But you could have also amplitude fluctuations and a combination of the two. And that's the idea we developed, is that that we will see we have a spoiler, another order, which is called a charge order, which is a competitor of superconductivity, and is ubiquitous in all these compounds. With the lanthanum, it's a bit more anti-magnetic. So the idea we take from that is an idea. It can be presented in different ways, and you will see it be presented in different ways. But basically, in one word, superconductivity doesn't fluctuate alone, but there is a competitor which also fluctuates, and you have fluctuations in between the two. Namely, superconductivity and the charge order are intimately related, and they are in a coherent superposition of two states with a constraint. Oops, it's not here, the constraint, sorry. With a constraint between the two order, which will implement the superposition. In one word, the idea we have is superconductivity and charge order, they are entangled. That's the idea we have, the ansatz we have for the pseudo gap. So there are various ways to realize entanglement. And one way you have in field theory to realize entanglement is to have an emergent symmetry. It's not the only one. I will present another one just a bit later. But this emergent symmetry is coming from chemistry. Sometimes energy levels are quasi-degenerate in an atom, and you have an extra symmetry between two ground states which has nothing to do with each other. So this emergent symmetry between superconductivity and charge, you rotate between one and another with an angle of rotation, and it's of SU2 in nature. So it's SU2 emergent symmetry here. It's described by nonlinear sigma model below the pseudo gap. So it's a chiral state. I don't know whether there are dions here. I don't think so, but it's still not the most simplest competition. It's still it's probably one level of exotism less than what Valérie presents. But I mean, we still go in that direction to give an answer for the pseudo gap here. So the model will be nonlinear sigma model below T star, and it's one of the chiral models of nature. So the idea is not new. You have, of course, if people remember, like Su Shen Zhang and Eugene Debler developed this SO5, where you were rotating superconductivity to antiferromagnetism. So this time the group is bigger, you have 10 generators, because you have three antiferromagnetic fields, but the idea is the same. Your idea of SU2 symmetry was also studied in a case of fractionalization of electrons. I mean, SU2 symmetry is also something strong for cuprates, because at half filling, the attractive about model, the symmetry is exact. So we have at least one point where it is exact. So we have one advantage compared to the SO5 symmetry is that we don't have the mode transition between the charge order and superconductivity here. Okay, so this is in a shorthand the SU2 symmetry concept for theoreticians in the audience. So here you have a triplet representation of set with superconductivity, a charge order, delta zero. And two superconductivity has a phase, which by nature superconductivity has a phase, so it's complex. So you have two states, and you have this called eta mode, which helps you to pass from one to the other over there. So here in this phase diagram, you will have one point over there and over there where the symmetry is exact. The idea is when you raise temperature, the symmetry will be restored, although a bit artificially, a bit as if you had a QCP. As I was telling you, you can describe that as work we did in 2013 with Konstantin Yefetov, and we found a model where it's exactly realized, and it's a model of 8 hotspots over there. So then the symmetry is exactly realized, and you have a composite order parameter, which is particle-particle and particle-hole with a constraint, which describes the system. Now, of course, you can tell me, okay, it's 8 hotspot model, so it's not the full Fermi surface, it's highly simplified, it's quasi 1D in nature. This is all true. So, okay, I introduced a competitor. I would like to just remind you about the questions about this competitor, which is the charge order. I know that neither Ivan nor Valerie did that, and I thought it basically the main idea where I'm talking about you about this today is to make also a review of this recent experimental development, which was very influential in the field. So, okay, so recently the phase diagram of cuprates has become more and more complex with an additional competitor, which is charge density wave observed here in the underdoped phase, but not only. So you also have observation for anomalous care effect, breaking of time Russell symmetry at T star, a glassy behavior there. Okay, incipient charge order has this wave vector, and we know that it's stabilized with a magnetic field, and it gives rise to 3D long-range order. So there are observations of pneumaticity that was outlined by Ivan as well. Loop currents, it's very debated, but they are there. And inversion symmetry by torque experiment. So we have a great complexity now of the phase diagram with the modulations over there. And a bunch, what they claim experimentalists tell you they are phase transition, but you see they are discrete symmetries, all of them. You break time of your soul, or you break parity, but you break every time a discrete symmetry. So it's as if the pseudo gap had a precursor. It's a question for all theoreticians. I mean, discrete symmetries of those kind, they are Galilean. They don't break Galilean invariants, so they cannot open the pseudo gap by themselves. But they must accompany any serious theory of the pseudo gap, which is not the most minimal challenge. Theories, I mean. So the presence of charge order in competition with superconductor is something which is also not new. You see this very famous example, the selenium-niobium telluride, where the charge order is here in blue and superconducting phases are in red here. You see the difference with cuprates, it's roughly 3 to 4, 5 times order of magnitude smaller. In cuprates, there are the temperature TC and T charge order are of the same order of magnitude. So it was first observed, I hope I don't make mistake here, so experimentalist friends will not go after me after the talk. So I like to say 2002, it's a long time ago, with the STM experiment. So if you see that, I don't see anything. But what they did very cleverly is subtract the 8 Tesla to the 0 Tesla. And then you see the vortices, very beautiful Breikozov lattice. And inside the vortices, you see the modulations very beautifully. So that's the key, because we know that what we see inside the vortices is what the normal phase is made of. I mean, you just kill superconductivity with magnetic field. What you see inside the vortices is what, it, I mean, it's a mechanism for making superconductivity. It's what the normal phase is built of, and what we see are modulations. So that's also an experiment by STM, but very recent this time by the group of Seamus Davis. This is so intriguing, gosh. So that's you see the charge order. It could be described like this with an amplitude and a phase slip. That's typically what people have for charge order. Cuprates are very disordered compound, and they are on the surface with STM. The phase slip is super disordered. So that's the random phase distribution you see normal. Again, they subtract L Tesla and 0 Tesla. You see the vortices. The phase slip inside the vortices is centered on 0. So the phase of the charge order is long range. Namely, just like this. Without magnetic, a strong magnetic field of 17 Tesla, the charge order is not long range, it's short range. Namely, I would say the amplitude. No. What did I do again? I'm really sorry. Yeah, that's me. So I say the amplitude has maybe a coherence length, which would be a little bit larger than the size of the vortex. But the phase is global on the. on the sample. How weird is that? You have a system of charge modulation which has a phase which is coherent on the three times larger scale than the amplitude is. How much I am with the time? Sorry? 10 minutes, okay. So, as I said, it will be an introduction, and I give you to know more about that and what other. There are 2 sessions. Mine will be on Wednesday. I will probably give more details on what we did with the theory on that. But I would like to continue a bit the introduction. So you see the charge order here. That's a function of magnetic field, function of temperature. You have the superconducting phase, and see how flat it is. This is amazingly flat. It's as if you had a spin flop, like a magnetism with a transverse field, and suddenly the spins are flopping. And that's actually within the SU2 theory. We describe it, so I told you the two orders are intimately linked, so we describe that with a pseudo spin flop. So it's what we did. I go quickly. This is exactly when you do Ginzburg-Landau theory for this model. And you see that in order to reach something which is close to experiment here, you get a lot of fine-tuning. With a coexistence phase, you get a lot of fine-tuning. And that's the one with the fine-tuning. And that's the one with the nonlinear sigma model. So it gives exactly what you want with a flat spin-flop with nonlinear sigma model. So if the symmetry is exactly realized, you get that, the emergent SU2 symmetry. And if you want to have a bit of coexistence, it's what they have in experiment, you need to break a bit this emergent symmetry. It's not be completely realized, but it's still flat. So for me, this experiment was extremely convincing. I mean, it's like if you had people who had a theory to guess that they would observe that in magnetic field. Look, at the moment, there is a guess for you guys. I mean, I know in Toulouse, they are putting 200 Tesla in pulse fields. So you can go in continuous fields, you cannot go up to 40 Tesla max. But with pulse, you can go to 200 Tesla. I mean, it's not yet done. So they will be able to destroy superconductivity for YBCO away from the charge order. And the question is what you will observe. Maybe this will solve the pseudo gap. Because if you observe nothing, it's probably topological order. And in this theory, in competition, they are in competition. So you have to observe the charge order. I mean, in lanthanum, they observe magnetism. So in lanthanum, you have more magnetism. So they observed the antiform magnetism was going just until the end of the pseudo gap. So that's the key question, maybe for any theoretician. What will they see? They believe they will see antiform magnetism, which I think they are completely wrong, but we'll see. Okay, so that's the sketch of the phase diagram. Something which is very interesting with current theories is when you have coexistence like that, you generate pair density waves. And that's even not with this kind of entanglement, but with competition, you generate the pair density wave, which is a symmetry of coexistence of charge order and superconductivity. But you generate at 4 lattice size. And there is a discussion that it has been observed at 8 lattice spacing by STM. Which, if it confirms that experimentalists agree on that, will kill the SU2 theory. But so far, X-ray didn't see anything at 8 lattice spacing. They saw things at around 4 lattice spacing. Okay, so that's what I will present on Wednesday. Maybe I will stop there. It's also a new idea for entangled states. I will just give the idea and so that it will be my introduction for Wednesday. So, as I told you, like there is this proximity to mode transition like theories where you cut the electron or fractionalize into charge alone and spin on with a constraint, and you have a fictitious gauge field transformation which is emergent over there. So the idea we had is to do the same but for a boson. So I mean an electron is kind of a elementary particle. I mean it's a solid thing. So what could we have as a particle which is not so solid? So we say, okay, let's try to fractionalize a pair density wave. This is a boson over there. So let's under strong coupling, you would form those things which are charged two bosons. That Ivan Bozovic likes them actually, not only him, but a few, and they would form at high energy. But then they are not very stable things. They are too complex. They are modulated in space, charged two bosons, and they have they are a particle-particle pair. So they would cut into a particle-particle pair at Q equals zero, the standard Cooper pair, and the charge modulation, particle hole. So we do this factorization for a boson with a constraint, and we have an emerging gauge field. And the ansatz for the pseudo gap is again a superposition of the two plus a constraint, so entangled state. So the entanglement comes from the constraint. Maybe I was not very precise here, but the constraint is what is opening the pseudo gap. And you can work with that in order to see whether it fits the experiment. So the effective model below T star is again a chiral model, which is here a quantum rotor model, and you can show it is equivalent by a gauge transform, actually a hop vibration or a gauge transformation to CP1 model. So it's equivalent to the theory of emergent symmetry, but there is no SU2 symmetry. There is just an emerging gauge field. And there probably links with what Valérie said this morning in terms of emerging gauge field. I don't know yet. I don't know his theory well enough to make the link. But in both cases, you have an emerging gauge field. The constraint opens the pseudo gap here at T star. And one thing which is very nice is here you have a lot of phase fluctuations. You have pairs, but they are highly incoherent. And you have pairs, particle-particle, particle-hole, and they are highly incoherent. And that's why I claim that you don't see exactly the phase fluctuation in an Nernst effect, because the competitor is kind of blurring everything. But what is interesting is the phase coherence between the two. The phase of the two orders get locked to each other below TC, which is extremely unusual when you think of it, because the charge phase is neutral electromagnetically, and the superconducting phase coupled to the electromagnetic field. So what I say is, when it kind of reconfines below TC, basically the charge density wave behaves like a pair density wave for all what symmetries is concerned. And that's the one way that's in the theory to explain. You remember this fantastic phase coherence observed in STM? You get it for free. even in the amplitude of the pair is not formed, I mean, they will glue their phase to the superconducting one. And then, since the superconducting phase is coherent on the bulk, the charge phase will become coherent, I mean the same block on the bulk. So I think I will stop here for today. I hope this introduction will give you also the will to come and listen to the nice sessions on cuprates. Certainly some of them will talk about charge order. Of course, I don't claim my theory is the right one. It's just ideas, and I think it's a nice thing about cuprates that new ideas could be tested and kind of very original theories. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. It's really nice talk. I have a question about the phase diagram of Yipko. And I guess that there is a two quantum critic points on this phase diagram. How to interpret this multiple quantum critical point on this diagram? And one is that maybe it's coming from the pseudo gap, but what about the others? Thank you.
Okay, let me just thank you for to ask this question, because actually it's true, I was not completely precise. So indeed, this is still under debate, the QCP here under the dome. And my view here is the situation for this one. There is another one here, is what you say. So indeed, they see kind of antiformatic fluctuations around this QCP. Are they powerful enough to explain the pseudo gap? Some people believe that it's the case. I personally don't, because neutrons don't see them above this point. I mean, if it was the case, neutrons should see a very strong signal. Maybe for lanthanum it's different because the stripes are magnetic. But this one over there is still debated experimentally. Basically, if you look at probes which probe the gap itself, like you look at ARPES, or on Wednesday, Alain Sakuto will present you something on Raman. So Raman sees the gap directly through the experiment. And what they see is it's very abrupt drop. They see that the gap is going like that, and boom, it's dropping. You see nothing after this PC. So if you look at these probes, you would be inclined to say, oh, but this is not at all a QCP. It's just a first order kind of transition or something like this, kind of orders in competition. Now, if you talk to spectroscopists like neutron scattering people or some other people who did the TORC experiment, all the people who observed this Z2 autom Russell symmetry breaking, this discrete symmetry breaking at T-star, they claim it goes to zero. So the situation could be that the gap itself is some kind of competition, some kind of a crossover, or something very exotic, like Valerie and I would like to sell you. But on top of it, you have to explain why you have this breaking of discrete symmetries, which could provide a QCP, definitely. They are more robust than continuous symmetries. They can happen at higher temperature, and they can provide a QCP over there with an increase of here the specific heat. Okay. That's just my view. Let's put it this way, it's still under debate.
Okay, thank
the
you.
Situation is complex as well.
Any question here?
So, okay. I suppose the question is theoretical. Let me try to answer. Experimentally, people saw nothing at all under the diagonal. Remember the Q, QX and QY? Under the magnetic field, we know. We know because there is Bragg reflection. So it's uniaxial, and it's made of one uniaxial. Without the magnetic field, it's more complex because it's disorder. So some people believe it's patches, one with one X Q and uniaxial patches of QX and QY. But nothing was ever seen on the diagonal, which is very weird. And if you do some theories to find the charge order, that's another mystery. All the theories would give you the main one main thing on the diagonal, like QX plus QY order, which was never seen. So that's the first mystery. Another mystery for the theories, if you do numerical simulation, like DMFT people have done for years, none of them has seen a charge order. So they just don't see it. So those guys tell you, well, it's all magnetic, and charge order is an epiphenomenon. And you understood that I don't believe in that, but still it's a real debate in the cuprates whether the charge order has anything to do with the pseudogap physics or not. So to find it theoretically, you need to have a strong coupling technique. We did recently find charge order with roughly the right wave vector using a Gutzwiller approximation with solving numerically a strong coupling technique. But it's not easy. So first you have to make your mind whether it's important or not for cuprates. So if you go to the talk by Alain Sakuto on Wednesday, he will tell you, he believes the same as me, is that it's important. And they claim they can see the charge order gap by Raman scattering, which would be something important because to see directly the charge order gap is something, for superconducting gap it's easy, for charge order it's not easy. Right. You see the modulations, but the size of the gap, I hope it answers everything. Yeah,
right. Catherine, thanks a lot. We have to have a short break because there are other sessions, so I think we should...
thank again the speaker and discuss with her later on. Thank you, Catherine.